All right. Thank you very much for the opportunity to present. Today, I'm going to be talking about a project that we conducted last year as a collaboration between the University of Adelaide and Flinders Uni. I'd also like to acknowledge that Jennifer Young, Adrian Lineker, and Phil Cassidy were also involved in the project. So the project overall looked at optimizing trace DNA detection methods for MT reptile holdings used in the illegal wildlife trade. So before I get too stuck into the project itself, I'd like to give a little bit of background to why we're interested in developing more optimal trace DNA screening methods. As Adam Toombs and Oliver Stringham have touched on earlier today, the illegal wildlife trade coupled with the globalization of tourism facilitates the international demand for exotic reptile species. And from a biosecurity standpoint, that means that the importation of key new incursion species can have potential related agricultural and environmental impacts, especially through establishment and spread of invasive species. So while this is strictly regulated, there's a low number of related prosecutions. So there needs to be a more optimal method for detecting these species in cases where there is no longer physical evidence and only trace evidence remains. So at Flinders University, a forensic genetics team there has been working on and developing latent trace DNA detection methods using diamond nucleic acid dye, which is an external groove binding dye, and typically it's used for gel electrophoresis. But they've recently applied it to the direct visualization of latent cells on surfaces. So what I'm showing here in this figure is panel A, a human thumbprint on a glass slide, which is at 50 times magnification and has had diamond dye applied to it. As you can see in the fingers groove pattern, you can see these individual green dots, and those are actually cells that have been stained with the diamond dye. Panel B indicates where we are recovering the trace DNA from that slide, and you can see it's a very targeted approach. And panel C there indicates that all of the cells that you can visualize on that surface are then being recovered with the swab head in panel D, indicating the fluorescence and the cells that you've recovered there. So the reason that this sort of thing was in development in the first place is because the financial and time-based costs associated with haphazard sampling and swab heads harboring no cellular material whatsoever. So previously, this sort of technology and research and development into using this for latent DNA visualization was limited to human forensic investigations, but recently this project has been looking at it from a wildlife forensic standpoint, particularly looking at reptiles. So that gets me to the research aims and objectives of the study that we conducted. So we obviously aim to apply trace DNA detection methods to facets of the illegal wildlife trade in reptiles. And within that, we had several objectives that translated into separate sections of the methods. So firstly, we wanted to visually detect trace DNA using diamond dye on two different surface types, those being glass and plastic surfaces. Secondly, we wanted to develop a novel assay for the amplification and quantification of the trace DNA once we had recovered it. And then lastly, of course, we want to identify the reptile species from those PCR products. In terms of the nominated species that we're interested in, I traveled to and from the Gorge Wildlife Park in South Australia. They provided access to 5 corn snakes and 4 boa constrictors. These species have been identified in the literature, and they're also on national priority lists as species that pose establishment risk and pose threats to agricultural and environmental assets. So these are the 2 focus species for my study. As far as the experimental setup goes, I've got an image here that shows one of the corn snakes present in one of the experimental tanks. So it was a 65-liter glass tank, which we sterilized with 10% bleach, followed by an absolute ethanol wipe down. Each individual of each species was present in the tank for 24 hours. We also monitored its movements using a trail camera that we mounted overhead. There were four tiles in each of the tanks. So they correspond in the diagonal. So we got two glass ones on this diagonal and then two plastic on the other diagonal. So once the 24-hour period had elapsed, we collect the tiles, we store them in a sterile box, and we take those to Flinders University for analysis. Once we're there, we spray the tiles with diamond dye and we visualize any of the trace DNA that we can see on those tiles. So in terms of the observations that we made, once we apply diamond dye to each of these tiles, we had three categorically different observations. Some of the tiles we had no observable pattern and a whole spectrum of from very little fluorescence to very high fluorescence. We also observed very defined movement patterns on some of the tiles. As you can see in the second column there, we have clear and defined movement patterns. And then the last column, of course, is the highly distinct features like scale imprints that we saw on the tiles or very obvious signs of movement. So once we had visualized the trace DNA on the tiles, we used swabs to recover all of the fluorescence that we were able to visualize on those tiles. And then we developed some novel primers, which we had designed in order to target reptiles specifically with the aim of excluding human trace DNA, as we established that that would be a source of cross-contamination in a biosecurity setting. So what I'm showing here is the melt curves from the qPCR assay, where B indicates boa constrictor. We got C for corn snake, S is for shingleback, which is another species we looked at, but I won't touch on that today. Then we have one here, which is a very high human load, and two, which is a much lower human load, more indicative of trace level. And what we're seeing here is that we are targeting the reptiles with high specificity with very defined peaks, and then we have these less defined and no peaks whatsoever for the human targets, indicating that we're targeting those reptiles with high specificity. Once we amplified up those products that we recovered from the tiles, we sent off a subset of those to the Australian Genome Research Facility for sequencing. We did the same for a couple of positive controls that we derived from shed snake skin samples. And what we found was high percentage identity and query cover for the positive controls, the experimental samples and reference samples that we were able to get from GenBank, which indicates that the fluorescence that we were seeing on the tiles corresponds to the trace DNA that was actually deposited by the reptiles that were present experimentally. So there were a couple of other things that we were interested in, because we found that in terms of visualization initially, we were getting a lot worse results for the plastic tiles. So we looked at the probability of amplification as well. And what we found is that there was a significant difference between the two material types, that being glass is highly preferential for trace DNA visualization and trace DNA recovery and amplification. So from a biosecurity standpoint, we found that glass surfaces were very useful for this pipeline. Where plastic surfaces, we may need to optimize the methods further. We also then wanted to link the visual detection back to the concentrations of recoverable trace DNA. So we classified for the glass tiles only, and where we did have amplification, each of the tiles is either high visible fluorescence or low and intermediate fluorescence lumped together. And what we found is there's a slightly higher concentration of recoverable trace DNA for tiles where we had high levels of fluorescence. However, it wasn't significantly different for each of these two categories, which indicates that we're not necessarily conforming to the relationship that they found with some of the human forensic science stuff, where they had a positive linear increase with number of cells present on the surface as fluorescence and the concentration of recoverable trace DNA. So in terms of the outcomes for the study, we used diamond dye to provide useful information about the reptile movement and presences. We then also had this effective qPCR assay. We were amplifying trace DNA for two key new incursion species, which is useful in a biosecurity setting. And then obviously these are some necessary steps towards operationalizing a standardized methodology for visualizing trace DNA in a biosecurity setting. In terms of the future research, we were using these tiles as proxies for the tank surface, but it would be really interesting to scale up the entire experiment and spray the entire tank, look at certain areas where we may be able to see high levels of fluorescence, see how those correlate with concentrations of recoverable trace DNA. And then, of course, we want to move into the next steps, which is research and development of an on-site presumptive testing method. Currently, we're looking at using loop-mediated isothermal amplification, which I'll touch on a little bit more on the next slide. And then we'll back that up using a lab-validated method. So in terms of the on-site presumptive testing, we've spoken a lot here about this step number one, using diamond dye as a trace DNA visualization tool, aiding sample collection. We then follow that by an extraction. And then we want to use this loop-mediated isothermal amplification, which is pretty similar to PCR in many ways. However, it's got a lower financial and time-based costs. It can be rolled out very rapidly, and it's also got limited resource constraints. And a big advantage of it is we can use colorimetric methods similar to if you were doing a presumptive drug test. You may be trying to detect a chemical. You see a color change if that chemical is present. What we want to do here is a similar thing. If we're detecting that reptile, we see a color change, and then we have a standardized way of imaging that, and then a standardized way of validating that result in the lab. So thank you very much. That's the end of my presentation. I'd just like to give a special thank you to everyone on screen for their help with the project, and of course, the conference itself for the opportunity to present today. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Nathan. I've got a couple of questions for you. One, arguably snakes in captivity, pet snakes are the most poorly housed pet of all, because we tend to keep them in cages where they can't actually extend their bodies. So have you thought about, and you said that you did have cameras where you were actually watching where the animal sat. Have you thought about whether the size of the cage might then increase or change or influence your detection rates, depending on whereabouts you sampled and also the actual dimensions relative to the animal?
Yeah, we have thought about that. That's the predominant reason as well why we would like to scale up the visualization to the entire tank, because using the tiles, we don't necessarily see whether the snake has spent the most time. So if we were to scale up to the entire tank and develop the method for spraying the entire tank and then visualizing it, we'll be able to tell more readily where that animal has spent most of its time. And I think that would provide more information and be more useful in scenarios like you're mentioning.
Great. I also wondered whether you could use it a little bit like the methods we've been using to detect COVID in whole suburbs, where you actually look at the bedding that they have been throwing out and see whether, you know, the bedding might abrade the DNA off the animals more readily, and you might be able to extract from that.
Yeah, that's something we could look into as well. The main thing with the diamond dye that we've been using, it's very useful for non-porous surfaces. Any time where things get porous, the dye tends to soak into the surface itself. So it's not necessarily as useful for those types of applications.
Thank you for that.